What I'm talking about, the contributions of Mises and Rothbard to economic thought. So that just that right there, to be clear, that I'm focusing narrowly on the economics. And even within that, I'm saying this is not going to be an exhaustive survey. Right? What I'm going to do is go through, highlight a few things, and then give you sort of in-depth treatment on a few items that are particularly important or things that I think that I'm competent in explaining, whereas other things, like especially in the philosophy and so forth, that wouldn't be my area of expertise, and so you've heard that from other people this week. Okay, so contributions of Mises. Now here, if you don't know what this is, that's Michelle Bachmann on the beach reading Mises. And that was just, I didn't waste time making that image. That was just a Google image search. But you Google Mises and that pops up somewhere. And just in case you guys don't get the reference, Michelle Bachmann is a sort of Tea Party aligned conservative candidate or office holder. And she apparently claims that she reads Mises on the beach, which, maybe she does. We don't know. This is Joe the plumber. He was a guy that achieved, again, for our foreign visitors here, he achieved a brief period of notoriety when in the 2008 campaign, the then candidate Barack Obama was going around, and this guy at a campaign stop says something like, yeah, I'm thinking about being a small business owner, and your plan to raise taxes is going to be detrimental to my aspirations. And Obama said something like, well, yeah, I think it's good, though, if we spread the wealth around. And they caught that on tape, and then that went around, and everybody, Sean Hannity and so forth, were going nuts that Obama's a socialist. So this guy, Joe the Plumber, was pretty famous for a while, and that Christmas, I think it was the American Spectator, asked him for reading lists, and one of the books he recommended was The Theory of Money and Credit. And he said that this is like important readings for these troubled times. So that was kind of funny because I'm guessing he didn't read Theory of Money and Credit. And for people, like especially people who are watching this online or after the fact, and you think that you're offended by what I'm saying, I'm not saying that blue collar people are dumb. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying I've heard Joe the Plumber at a Tea Party event give a talk. I don't think he grapples with the regression theorem at night. That's all I'm saying. All right, so we're talking about Mises now. Methodology. First of all, I mentioned this in previous years. I'm not giving that particular lecture, so let me take the opportunity now. Just as a little quibble in terms of the usage. Method and methodology are different words, right? They mean different things. So it's annoying, and not that many people care about this, but you will, if you go into academia, you will run into some referees or some journal editors or some people on your committee that are as anal as I am. So I just want to point this out, that some of us care about this kind of thing. If you say in your paper, like you're going to run a regression, you say, my methodology in this paper is to take GDP and regress it against, income and blah, 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 and weather and so forth. That's not right. That's not your methodology. That's your method. Right? Methodology means you're writing about method. So what I would say here is Mises' methodological works is when he's talking about what method should we use in economics. So this is something that I didn't realize myself for a while. Initially, when Mises was writing on this and explaining how is it that we do economics properly, he wasn't telling other economists, hey, you guys are wrong. Stop trying to be like the physicists and do it instead this way, like I'm saying, use a verbal, logical, deductive analysis. No, initially, Mises was just telling other economists, hey guys, I don't know if you've ever thought about it like this, but look at this is what we're doing actually. When we do economics and it's good, this is what we do. Right? And so at least initially, his point wasn't to sit in the corner and wag his finger at everybody else. Initially, he was just telling all the economists, this is the way we do economics properly, and then it was only later in his career that as the rest of the profession sort of moved away from that and embraced, especially like I think Paul Samuelson was the pivotal moment that Paul Samuelson started cranking stuff out that was very mathematical, that was quite consciously modeled after mathematical physics. And then other economists thought, wow, this guy's a sharp guy and we want to be like him. And so I think he was the model, and that's what really made mainstream economics so mathematical that nowadays we just take it for granted. But when Mises was first writing this stuff, his methodological regs, again, he didn't think he was telling other economists that they were doing something wrong. He was just trying to explain to them, hey, I've taken a step back and this is what we're actually doing, in case you guys never thought of it like that. If you want to get that, if you want to see some evidence of that documented, this is a great place to get it in Hoppe's short booklet on this issue. He's got a bunch of quotes from older, like classical economists showing that this tradition is there. So again, it's just not that Mises made this up out of whole cloth. And the other thing is, you will see the strongest claims for the power of this sort of approach in Hoppe's pamphlet here, right? Even more than you would even see it in Mises. That, let me put it this way, you rarely hear someone say something like, yeah, you know that guy over there? He's kind of like Hans Hoppe, but more so. Nobody ever says that, right? That when Hoppe is going to take a position, he really takes it to the extreme. So what I'm saying is, if you want to see this thing really, like the power of and claims made on behalf of the strength of a sort of logical, deductive, praxeological approach versus the empirical approach, then I would definitely recommend that book. Just to give you some idea, I personally never really cared that much about praxeology in terms of the a priori stuff. I mean, I knew what it was, and I thought, okay, it wasn't that I thought it was wrong, but I just thought, no, I could teach me about the business cycle, about purchasing power of money, that sort of thing. And I never really thought that, you know, why are we wasting our time telling people no humans act, and like we do, I didn't really care. It was really after reading Hoppe's pamphlet here that I realized, wait, this is kind of deep, this is an important thing, and you know, I need to figure out where I stand in this. So I'm not giving a blanket endorsement of this. I think all the faculty, we all disagree with each other on various things, but I am saying, for what it's worth, if you've never gotten all fired up about the praxeological method per se, and of course you're afraid to admit that because you get, you know, dunked in the pool or something at the dorm, you try reading this, and at least you'll see why, oh, this is why some people get so fired up about it, because if this is right, this is really powerful stuff. Okay, let me give you two quick examples of what I'm talking about. So supply and demand, something real simple, and this is what I would tell my students when I was teaching just principles. I would try to get them to see that, strictly speaking, we don't have a theory of supply and demand. It's not that we have this theory, like there's market prices out there, and I'm going to have this conjecture with which to explain them the way a physicist might say, well, the moon's going around the Earth, and let me make a conjecture that, okay, I think that there's this thing called the law of gravity that behaves and operates on the moon, between the moon and the Earth, the way it does between the Earth and an apple, and let me come up with some predictions of that and see if it's verified or falsified. That's not at all what we do when we try to explain prices as economists using supply and demand. That framework is just it's a framework. It's a lens or a toolbox. It's a way that we look out at the world. It's how we interpret prices. So there's nothing that could ever happen that would make us say, oh my gosh, supply and demand are wrong. No matter what happens, we would just be able to handle that outcome using our supply and demand framework. So that is the germ of truth in the criticism that other people, that empiricists will give to Austrians, saying, oh, you guys, it's just a religion. You know, you're insulated from ever being wrong. No matter what happens, you're always right. And so, you know, you're not using science here. This is just religion. Well, yes and no. It is true that no matter what happens, you wouldn't ever stop using, or you wouldn't ever say, oh, supply and demand has been falsified. But our point is, just everything we do in terms of basic economic theory, in terms of how do economists view the world, in terms of what we mean by saying the economic way of thinking, all of that is non-falsifiable in the sense that those people mean that term. Right? So just something as simple as the statement, incentives matter. Right, that's clear. Like, I think just any economist you grabbed would say that, yeah, that is a crucial part of the economic way of thinking. That's, if you don't think that incentives matter, you're not an economist. And if you are an economist, you think that. So what, but you say, okay, that statement that incentives matter, could that ever be falsified? And no, it couldn't, because I could say, well, what if I walk up to you and I say, hey, I'll give you $50 if you let me chop your toe off. And then you say, well, no. Did I just prove incentives don't matter? No, I just proved that offering you $50 wasn't incentive enough to let me chop your toe off, right? So you just think through it like that. There's no way you could possibly test the claim that incentives matter. You just have to just decide, I'm going to use that in my view of the world, explaining human action. I'm going to assume that incentives matter and to see, can I make better explanations of things using that approach than if I deny that incentives matter? Now, what is true, if you wanted to get empirical, you might see in certain settings incentives matter more than you would have thought, or more than the average person would have thought. Okay, so there's empirical studies showing things like with changes in tax laws, So like it changes to inheritance laws that people, let's say they change the tax code so that if people die in this one calendar year, they're going to get hit with a bigger tax bill for their estate than if they can die the next calendar year. Well, they've done empirical studies where that stuff has happened, and there seems to be a sharp drop off in the rate of death in December and a spike in January the following year. Right, so that's kind of shocking to people at first, because you would think that, the person who thinks economists are crazy and you think everyone's a bunch of robots responding to incentives mechanically, that's a perfect example where economists might predict empirically that, we should see some sort of effect because of the change in the tax law on the measured rate of death in December versus January the following year. And you do see that, and then you try to figure out, what's going on? Is it really, did they actually die at different times, or did they die like in December 28th? And the people at the hospital just fudged the report because they knew the family would make hundreds of thousands more. There's questions about that. Or is it just that the person decides to really hang on because he knows, I don't want to give more money to the government, and that's possible too. But anyway, the point is, there's a continuum there between the pure theory versus the empiricism. And in practice, I'm sloppy myself with mixing those two up. But in terms of the strict theory, to say incentives matter, I'm an economist, and I'm going to use that insight to help explain human behavior, that's not falsifiable. And just about anything that even empirical economists mean, if you just ask them off the top of their head, hey, what does it mean to think like an economist? All the stuff they give you, that's not going to be testable. Okay, another example, methodological individualism. So here, what I'm talking about, what are these examples of? I'm saying this is flowing from Mises's claim that the science of economics, itself, what we mean by pure economic theory, is logically deducible from the fact that humans act. So what I'm claiming is this, it's not that Austrians start out with the action axiom and then supplement it by saying, and by the way, we also believe in methodological individualism. I'm saying if you really think through the implications of saying people act, then you are doing methodological individualism. You have to be. It's a necessary thing, because to say, what does it mean if you say, I think that there's action, you mean when I look out at the world, I'm not going to interpret it merely as mindless matter in motion, the way a physicist or a chemist would, that you're going to say, no, partly the way I explain what I'm observing as a social scientist is to say there are other conscious entities at work, there are subjective goals out there that certain beings are trying to achieve, and that's partly how I'm making sense of what's going on as a social scientist. So to say that there is action, well, there has to be an actor. It wouldn't make sense to say that there's a conscious being out there with goals it's trying to achieve, but I don't believe in individuals, right? That doesn't make any sense, right? So that's the kind of thing I mean. And on one hand, it's almost trivial, but on the other hand, it's pretty deep, right? Especially since there are so many social scientists who deny the usefulness of methodological individualism. All right, let's move to a different topic, money. So here, Mises made amazing contributions. If I had to pick, that might be his most important in terms of, not necessarily importance for the human race, but importance in terms of the development of pure economic theory. I mean, if he just did this, he would have a place in the annals of the history of economic thought. So what I'm focusing on here is the stuff that he did in the theory of money, what's called in the English translation, the theory of money and credit. So one thing he did is, I didn't catch this until I just reread it recently to do the study guide. If you guys don't know, it's not physically available yet, but the PDF of my study guide to theory of money and credit just got posted like last week. So in rereading it, I was blown away by Mises creating this taxonomy. So he has all the different types of things that could be considered money or related to money, and he had to figure out a system to classify it all. And he goes through and comes up with these terms where the translations are things like money in the narrower sense, money substitutes, fiduciary media, and so forth. And again, just to confess to you, when I first got into that stuff, I said, you know what, that's not worth my time. I'm not going to learn all these different distinctions. I'm just going to learn what's the business cycle theory, okay. So going through this again, I was bracing myself to be bombarded with all of these arbitrary terms that Mises was throwing at me. And the point is, yeah, there were a few terms, but they weren't arbitrary. He not only does he give you the terms and their definitions, but he explains to you as he's doing why he chose it that way, All right, so there's a method behind it. And specifically, it has to do with the fact that you need to have this terminology in order to understand his theory of the business cycle. So the point is, for example, fiduciary media, I realize some of you are newcomers here, and so these terms might be scary. What fiduciary media means, it's money substitutes that are issued that aren't backed by the actual money commodity. So in our times now, fiduciary media would mean that when commercial banks have more checkbook deposits than they actually have cash in the vault or reserves with the Fed, right? So it's fractional reserve banking. But the point is, why did he come up with these terms? Is because he needed to have two things going on. He wanted to be able to incorporate the sense in which if you write a check and go buy something at the store, that's money in a very legitimate sense, just like if you give them a $100 bill, if you write them a check for $100 that's drawn on your checking account, you know, in a certain sense, those are both $100 that you have, and that helps to explain why prices are what they are. Whether you buy something with a $100 bill or write a check for $100, you're pushing up the price of that thing. Okay, those are almost equivalent as long as people think that check is instantly convertible into a $100 bill. But on the other hand, you can't just say, okay, so that's all money, and I'm not going to make any distinctions. He wants to say, no, there's money in the narrower sense, and then there's this thing called money substitutes, and it matters if those things like the checkbook balance is fully backed by cash, because if it's not, that leads to the business cycle. Right? So that's why he makes all these distinctions, because he wants to be able to explain the relationship between the stock of money and prices, but he also knows a few chapters later in the book, he's going to talk about what we call the Misesian theory of the business cycle. So that's why he needs to have all these distinctions. All right, so my point is just reading it with fresh eyes and then knowing where he ended up with it, it's sort of impressive that you know he was a young guy doing that, and it's kind of, you know, it was a bold thing for him to do, to just say, you know what, I'm just going to start making up terminology because the framework that everyone else has developed up till now isn't useful to solve these two twin problems. Okay, here's a big one. I'm going to spend a few minutes on this, and I'll try to, so just so you know, to pace yourself, this is going to be the topic that I'll spend the most time in this lecture on, because it's a little bit subtle, but it's pretty important. And then when we get to Rothbard, this stuff will be more fun. So if you only have a limited amount of energy, just really keep yourself, you know, if you see someone nodding off, nudge them or something, stay awake for this one, and then when we get to Rothbard, that will be more light and fun. Okay, marginal utility theory to money. Let me first explain to you why this was an issue. All right, so Menger, of course, pioneer in subjective marginal utility theory, that comes out in 71, early 1870s, Menger and then two other guys, Walras and Jevons, came out with this subjective marginal utility approach to explaining prices. All right, and you guys have heard all that if you've been going to the lectures all week, you know that story. What I'm telling you now is, which may not have been made clear, they couldn't, even the Austrians, like Bombaverk and Wieser and so forth, they could not take that in a fully satisfactory manner, explain the price of money using this framework. All right, so they could explain why is it that an orange in equilibrium trades for two apples. They could explain that using subjective value theory. That was simple. But they couldn't really explain why is it that one unit of money exchanges for two apples. Right? And so you might say, well, what's the issue? Well, the problem was, of course, anyone could see the straightforward application of that. You would just say, oh, well, the reason that we look out in the marketplace and we see that the exchange rate is that one unit of money trades for two apples is that people have subjective value scales, and it must just be the case that if you look at their rankings, you know, this guy's ranking, he has a bunch of units of money, and it must be that that particular unit falls here, and so he gains by trading that away for two apples, and this guy over here has a bunch of apples and not as much money, and if you look at his rankings, then, you know, he gains from giving up two apples and getting one unit of money. All right, so of course you can say that, and that's fine, but the point is, they said, something's fishy there, because when it comes to oranges and apples, as economists, it's fine to just say, well, people are hungry and they get satisfaction from eating fruit, and people are different, and so that's why you have these differences in their valuations on the margin. And that's where the explanation stops. You don't need to probe further and say, why is it ultimately that people want to acquire apples or oranges? We can just take that as a fact. But with money, the problem is, why do you want to hold money, especially if it's fiat money? That's really a problem. And the only reason is, oh, because it has purchasing power. I'm going to be able to trade it away for goods in the future. So the economists at the time thought subjective margin utility theory doesn't work with money because you're just arguing in a big circle. What you're trying to do is explain why money has purchasing power, and you're giving an explanation that assumes money has purchasing power. So really what you're saying is, oh, the reason somebody would give up valuable goods and services for money is because he knows other people will give up valuable goods and services for money. So it looks like you're just arguing in a big circle. So that was the issue. And so Mises solved that problem. So let me show you how he did it. Okay, obviously I'm taking liberties with this. I'm trying to make it more palatable for you guys. It wasn't that Mises was doing it in terms of days of the week, but I think I'm going to give you something that's consistent with his explanation that maybe is a little bit easier for you to grasp. Okay, so there's this guy on Friday, all right, and what we're trying to explain, we want to understand why does money have purchasing power on Friday? So what does it mean for money to have purchasing power? It means he's going to sell something, let's say it's his cool car with gold-wing doors, and he sells that in exchange for money. And I'm purposely using fiat money because that makes the problem more difficult, right? That clearly the only thing you use fiat money for is in its role as a medium of exchange. So let's actually do it with fiat money. So that's the issue. Why did he do that? That's what we're trying to explain. Why is it that he would give away a really cool car that can do all sorts of things in exchange for this thing that is intrinsically useless? You know what I mean? He could use it to burn, you know, and make some warmth, but clearly that's about it. Okay, or you can use it as a bookmark or something. But in terms of the direct utility of that thing, it's pretty low. So that's what we're trying to explain. Why is it that this stuff has purchasing power? Why is it that somebody who's off screen here was able to acquire a car on Friday with a bunch of these green pieces of paper? That's the problem. So we're trying to explain money's purchasing power on Friday. Why is it that money can get you a cool car on Friday? So now the answer goes like this. Well, because this guy looks ahead and he realizes that on Saturday, if he has that money, he'll be able to trade it away for stuff that he wants, like a burger or something like that, okay? So that's why on Friday he did that. He gave up his car to get the money on Friday because looking ahead, he anticipated that money would allow him to enter the marketplace and acquire goods and services on Saturday. All right, so now you say, okay, well, how did he... But now the issue is, okay, but you're just sort of making stuff up. How does he know what the purchasing power is? Like, why wouldn't he... why doesn't he sell the car? How does he know to sell the car for $100,000, or why doesn't he sell it for 10 cents? Or why doesn't he insist on getting $2 billion for it? How does he know what the purchasing power of money is? And they say, oh, because he looks ahead and gauges what he thinks the purchasing power is going to be in the near future. And so then you say, okay, but... how does he know that? Why doesn't he think it's going to be, a burger going for 2 pennies or a burger going for $2 billion tomorrow? And the answer that Mises gives is because he has a memory of prices in the recent past. He knows that on Thursday, a certain amount of money would exchange for a certain ratio with other goods and services. Okay, so already let's stop. And Mises has already broken out of the circularity problem. Because before, the way other economists were thinking of it, they thought somebody who tried to use a subjective marginal utility approach would say the reason money on Friday has purchasing power is that money on Friday has purchasing power. And they would say, you just argued in a circle. So already we're out of that circularity claim because now that's not what we're saying. We're saying the reason money has purchasing power on Friday is because the people accepting money anticipate it's going to have purchasing power on Saturday. And how do they know that? What's the basis for their expectations? They remember what the purchasing power of money was on Thursday. Okay, so we've broken out of we're not arguing in a circle. But now it looks like you say, okay, but what about, how did he know about the purchasing power on Thursday? And of course, he remembered it. How do you explain what it was on this day? It'd be the same thing. The people here accepting money were looking ahead to Friday because they remembered it on Wednesday and so on. You just keep going back. So then, and this is, now you, I'm sure most of you are familiar with this, is what the regression theorem was. Because you say, okay, you've eluded the circularity problem, Mises, but now it's just a problem of an infinite regress. It's true. You're not saying the purchasing power of money on Friday is explained by the purchasing power of money on Friday. Fair enough. But really, Mises, now all you're telling us is the purchasing power on Friday is explained by our memory of the purchasing power on Thursday. So come on, that's not an explanation because you're just going to keep doing that forever. And Mises says, no, I'm not going to keep doing it forever. With the case of fiat money, we go back. So, of course, it's not money. It's way back to when that would exchange for the precious metals, like a commodity money. And then how do we explain that? Well, then you push it back even further and say, how do you explain the purchasing power of the commodity money? You go back to the origin of money when it first emerged out of barter or direct exchange, when people were using gold for its own intrinsic value, right? So people used to, you know, use value gold for its role as jewelry or, you know, for industrial applications and so forth. So you can keep pushing it back until the point at which the commodity money was valued just as a commodity. And then Menger has showed us how you explain the purchasing power or the relative prices of commodities when there isn't a medium of exchange. Okay, so that is what Mises did. He explained it right now today using that little, you know, time, introducing the time element, and then he just kept tracing it back to the point at which the commodity money emerged from direct exchange. Okay, so that is, that whole thing is what we generally call is the regression theorem, but my point is Mises was the first one to really show that, no, we don't need two different sets of explanations, because economists up till then tended to do what we would now think of as micro price theory in real terms and explain relative prices using subjective marginal utility analysis. But then when they wanted to explain the absolute money prices, they would revert to real holistic macro concepts, right? So they would know using marginal utility analysis, oh, one apple trades for two oranges in equilibrium. But then when they wanted to say, well, what are their prices? Is it $1 and $2 or $1.50? Or is it $10 and $5? They need to say, well, what's the stockpile of dollars and what's the velocity of circulation? And so, you know what I mean? So they would switch to these macro concepts to explain absolute money prices. And Mises was showing here, you don't need to do that. You can just use subjective marginal analysis on money. It's just a little trickier. Okay, what else did he do? He talked about trade cycle theory. And what's amazing is this stuff I've been talking about the last 10 minutes, this was all in just one book. You know, I mean, this is Mises saying, hey guys, I think I'm an economist. What do you think? You know, I mean, it's just amazing. Okay, what he did here, and again, if you go through and read it, I know it's intimidating, but I would encourage those of you, especially if you're getting PhDs in this stuff, try reading through the theory of money and credit, because you're going to be blown away. It's not merely that Mises is a good theorist and has a sharp mind, but he has read everything. Like, he just, you know, refers to banking literature and stuff in the footnotes, and this part in particular, the trade cycle theory, on the one hand, it would be almost more impressive if he just dreamt it all up off the top of his head, but no, you appreciate that he just read a bunch of stuff and absorbed things from various schools. So it's not simply that he read Menger and then Bombaver and then just tweaked it. He read everything and then decided what did he like in various thinkers' writings, and then what didn't he like even in his own mentors' writings, and he came up with what he thought the most satisfactory explanation was. So here, the trade cycle theory actually draws on all these things, that the classical wages fund doctrine, so the notion that, you know, when you think about why is the boom unsustainable, well, that kind of goes back to the classical economists and their view that what the capitalists do is they save up the actual consumption goods. So the way some of the classical economists thought about it is the capitalist has tuna fish and meat and milk and so forth and shelter, and then the workers come up with nothing, and the capitalist says to them, okay, here, I'll give you some food, I'll give you this, I'll give you shelter, and you work on this project for me, and then 5 years from now it'll be ready, and then I'll reap all the returns. And meanwhile, I'm giving you sustenance, and that's what's keeping you alive. So that fund of savings is what out of which wages were paid, because the output from the work wasn't going to accrue until later. So that was the classical conception of how the capitalists interact with the workers and why the capitalists get a certain amount of interest income out of the annual produce. So if you think about it, that is in the Austrian theory of the trade cycle, because that's the notion of the unsustainable boom, that there is not enough real savings to carry us through that people are going to start griping because their real consumption is going to have to fall at some point. Also, of course, drawing on Bombeverkian capital theory, this what's called either the English or the British currency school of banking theory, these people had a theory of booms related to the expansion and contraction of bank credit. And the interest theory of Wicksell, who had this idea of the natural versus the market or contractual rate of interest. So it was Wicksell who came up with the notion that if we push the interest rate below the natural level, that could screw things up. All right, so Mises drew on all that stuff to give what we all now learn this week as the Austrian theory of the trade cycle. Okay, as if that wasn't enough. Oh, by the way, he came up with the socialist calculation argument. You know, just he was a busy guy. So let me just point out that this was, and again, you guys have presumably heard this unless you were skipping lectures this week, so you know what the argument is. Let me just put it in the context. So this, historically, is stronger than the incentive argument. So before Mises came along and really drove home this point, of course, there were people who were socialists writing and advocating socialism before Mises came along, and there were conservative economists and social pundits and so forth that were opposed to it. But the traditional argument, the traditional objection to socialism was to say, well, if we just take what everybody makes and put it into a giant pool and then give it out based on, you know, egalitarianism or based on some other criteria, like if you have more people in your family, then you get more food or whatever, that's going to really break down the incentives. And so that's why it won't work, that the productivity of labor is going to go way down because the worker's not going to work as hard for society as he's going to work for his own family. And that's probably, you know, that may be true, but the socialists would just come back and say, well, you're right. People right now act like that, but that's because they've been raised in this cutthroat capitalist world. They've been trained to think, and they have to behave that way because otherwise they would starve the way this crazy system works. But if people were born into a socialist utopia where the productivity of labor was unimaginably high because we didn't have all the, you know, exploitation from the capitalists, then they wouldn't think like that. Their natural instinct to just create things for its own sake and just to give gifts to humanity would manifest itself, right? So the new socialist man. So whether, you know, you might think that's crazy or might think it's fine, but the point is that's where the debate was, and it was kind of an impasse. So Mises, by saying, you know, rhetorically, he stipulated all that. He said, yeah, let's suppose the worker is just as happy to take orders from the central planner and will do whatever he's commanded to do. And let's also assume that the planners are nice guys, right? So we're not even bringing in the issue of corruption and, you know, the dangerous concentration of power, which obviously is a real concern. And he said, stipulate those two things. Still, they would lack the ability to rationally allocate resources. So that's why it was such a powerful argument. Just historically, I mean, you know it was important because, I mean, Hayek says, and I think it's in one of the introductions to the book Socialism, that it's, you know, Hayek himself, and he says something like, and all the other good men of the day were socialists. And what he means by that is that people who were concerned and wanted to help humanity, they honestly thought that the way to do it was socialism. And then when they read Mises, you know, he just blew up their worldview. And they had to grapple with that. So it's kind of refreshing to see that at least among some intellectuals, they can be swayed by other people's books, that it's not just a pure ideological thing. Let me just make one clarification here. A lot of times I hear people say stuff like, you know, there was a socialist calculation debate in the 20s and the 30s, and at the time people weren't sure who was right, but then when the Soviet Union fell, everyone realized Mises had been right. And I mean, that I understand the spirit in which people say that, but technically, Mises wasn't making an empirical prediction about how long could a socialist regime maintain order. He was saying, no, from day one, the socialist planners don't know how to calculate. They can't rationally allocate resources. And so that's what the argument is. Now, you can take that and say, because of that fact, given what we know about people and their willingness to support various regimes and so on, you know, could a socialist order stick around for 200 years? Well, maybe not. But my point is that Mises was not, strictly speaking, making a prediction about a regime's ability to maintain power. He was saying, could the planners rationally allocate resources? Okay, why is this important? It's not simply a matter for socialism per se. that in general, by him talking about the limits of socialism, I think that forced Mises to appreciate what happens in a market economy. So it was only when he thought about why wouldn't a socialist arrangement work that then led him and also Hayek to do some of their most important work on the nature of a private property economy and the importance of calculation. So at the last Rothbard graduate seminar, we went through human action, and it was it really struck me again how much calculation is at the heart of Mises' view of basically human civilization. Right, so he really makes some strong claims on behalf of how important calculation is. And again, you need to, when we say, what do we mean by calculation? He means the ability to reduce things to the common denominator of money, that a business person needs to be able to look at outputs and inputs and compare them. Okay, contributions of Murray Rothbard. How much time we got here? Okay, yeah, we're good on time. Okay, one thing people might say, oh yeah, Rothbard, he was a good writer and he explained stuff for the layperson, but he didn't really contribute that much. And I always want to say, even if that were true, well, so what? I mean, Man, Economy, and State is much easier to read than Human Action is. And so when people come up and ask me, which one should I read first? I was like, what are you kidding? Read Man, Economy, and State. I mean, that's not even an issue. That it worries me when people say, yeah, I'm getting interested in this Austrian economics, so I think I'm going to try to read Human Action. I get worried that they might get three chapters into it and give up and then just walk away and say it's too hard. And so that's why I always think people should read Rothbard first. So again, if he did nothing besides just explaining that, then that would be an amazing contribution, because he would evangelize, bring the message, bring the gospel of Mises, if you want to get silly with it, to a lot more people that way. And I think we sometimes just take it for granted, oh yeah, Murray Rothbard was a good writer, but you don't realize how good he is unless you try to read other economists and academics and just... Anyway. Okay, analysis of monopolies and cartels. So I just have two more points, and I'll turn over to your questions. So here I was focusing more on Mises just because I really wanted to drive home that point about money and its purchasing power. So here I'm not doing justice to Rothbard, and maybe in the Q&A, if Walter or somebody thinks I've left out something big, he wants to plug it. So let me just focus on a few things that I personally loved in terms of Rothbard's analysis, things that were clearly his contributions. Okay, so he disputed this whole notion of monopoly the way that the conventional textbooks used it, and even the way Mises used it, all right? So that's, for one thing, that just shows it's not true, this claim that, oh, Rothbard was just a follower of Mises and never thought Mises did anything wrong. No, in Man, Economy, and State, Rothbard, he does it very gently and politely, but he criticizes a lot of the stuff that Mises did. So one thing in particular is he's saying this idea that there's such a thing as the competitive price that we could contrast with the market price in the absence of a government privilege. And he has a lot of cute examples to drive home the point. And again, it's so light and fun that when you're reading it, you almost think, oh, this can't be a deep analysis because it's not giving me a headache. But it's really, they're brilliant points. Just things like take a heavyweight prize fighter. And with the conventional analysis, you might say, well, gee, if this guy, who is the heavyweight champ right now? Who? Kitschko? Okay. Is that a person or an animal? All right. So, all right, I kind of fell out once Mike Tyson bit that guy's ear. I got out of it. Okay, so the point is, that in a sense, that person is withholding, restricting production. That person has a monopoly on how many heavyweight defenses there are per year, and the person could be fighting more. Or take like your favorite band. If they had a concert every 3 days, they would be providing more service for their fans. So why don't they do that? And part of the reason is, first of all, they'd be exhausted, but also you'd say, and you could also say, well, they wouldn't have time to write new stuff if they were always touring. But another clear reason is their manager or whoever, their accountant, could say, if you held a concert every 3 days, you would earn less total money. You'd have to lower tickets prices enough to be able to keep doing that you'd actually probably make less total money per year than if you do it the way you're doing right now. So there, what are they doing? Oh my gosh, they're restricting production in order to raise prices. Oh my gosh, that's what the monopolist does. And so why doesn't some other band come in and do that? Well, because you know that band is what it is. And you could have people doing covers or whatever, but in terms of being U2, there's only one U2, right? So someone else can't be that. So the point is that analysis holds there, but yet when it comes to things like heavyweight fighters or professional musicians, it doesn't seem as big a deal. So Rothbard's point is, why is it a big deal if the person making computers does that or cars does that? He also has a neat little argument where he goes through the conventional analysis of why cartels are supposed to be so bad. And he says, well, how is that different from what we think of just a standard corporate merger or even just the formation of a corporation in the first place? That there you've got a bunch of people pooling their assets to form one entity that's going to then make joint decisions about production and so forth. So how is that different from what a cartel is, where you got a bunch of initially distinct units joining their financial resources in order to make joint decisions about output and pricing and so forth? That what's the difference? All right, he's got a good critique of consumer sovereignty. And again, this is an area where this is something Mises believed in and touted, and Rothbard opposes it. So just to give you a quick summary of it, Mises, one of the reasons he touts the market economy is he said it fulfills consumer sovereignty, in fact, much better than the democratic process does. That when in terms of bringing power, if you will, to the common man, that's the market economy for you. And his point is, he's got some famous passages where he says, the conventional man, especially the socialist reformer, looks at a market economy and thinks that the capitalists or the entrepreneurs are the ones that are in charge, that they're making all the decisions. They decide how many cars to produce. They decide what models to make and so on. And he said, but really, they're not. They're actually the ones just steering the ship. The actual captain, the one who's like sitting in the big command chair, is the consumer. So it's the consumers who are giving the orders. And yes, to the superficial view, it looks like the capitalists are the ones controlling things and controlling the means of production, but they're only granted that temporarily because the consumers have decided, okay, you're doing a pretty good job fulfilling our wishes, so you get to, you know, get your hands dirty and you deal with the day-to-day details here. But if we decide later on that you're not doing what we want, we'll revoke your ability to do that, and we'll put somebody else in your place. Okay, so Mises goes through and uses that metaphor to describe what happens in a market economy. So Rothbard doesn't like that. He says, for one thing, it's this term sovereignty, it's just misleading. He says, it's not true that the consumer is sovereign over producers. The consumer can't literally order you to go into a certain line of production. He said, rather than that, I think people should just have individual self-sovereignty. That as a producer, you own your body, so you own your labor services. If you have natural resources, you control how they're used. If you have capital goods, you can control what lines of production they're incorporated into. But nobody can force you to do that. And the same thing with the consumer, you can buy products or not, and then you just all come together and then reach voluntary, mutually beneficial arrangements. So Rothbard thinks it's misleading to call that consumer sovereignty. Monopolistic competition. Okay, so I actually lied. I have two more slides. So these are two different arguments from man, economy, and state that I always just thought were great. So let me just walk you through them. So here, and for those of you who have not seen this kind of stuff, if you haven't taken economics at the undergraduate level at least, this might be a little bit above your head. I'll try to not leave you behind here. So this is a conventional diagram showing the evils of monopolistic competition and the benefits of pure, perfect competition. So the standard textbook exposition says under pure competition, all the producers perceive a perfectly elastic demand curve. So they think, you know, for a given price, they think they could sell as many units as they want. And if you run through the diagrammatic exposition, that means that in equilibrium, in a perfectly competitive market, you're going to set output at the point, the minimum on this AC curve here. That's average cost. Whereas under monopolistic competition when the firms have market power, when they think they have some influence over price, what that means is the firms face a downward sloping demand curve. They realize that, oh, wait a minute, if we want to sell more, we have to lower the price. That's what it means to say they face a downward sloping demand curve. Whereas here, they think, no, we could sell as many units as we want at the market price because we're such a small component, we can't affect a price. Whereas under monopolistic competition, you're a big part of the market. And so, you know, to be more realistic, you realize if we double our output, we couldn't keep selling at the same unit price. So who cares? What's the big deal? Well, in a standard mainstream textbook, they're going to say, oh, the big deal is if you do the calculus or whatever, you see the equilibrium profit maximizing point for the monopolistic competitor as opposed to the firm in perfect competition is where there's this tangency here, and that's going to happen. So look at output gets restricted and prices go up. And the other thing is this is at a higher point on this average cost curve than this point was. So they're going to say, see what happens if you initially start with a perfectly competitive market and then a bunch of the firms grew, like kept merging. So now you just had like six big firms that all had market power. What's going to happen? They're going to all restrict output. Prices are going to rise and production is going to occur at higher average unit costs. And then the textbooks try to give some real world examples, like, well, okay, this is just geometry. What do you mean though? And they're saying, well, if it's something like, wheat farmers, well, that's a perfectly competitive market. Everyone sells wheat the same price. There's no differentiation, and they're not advertising, right? It's not that Farmer Joe says, buy my wheat. It's better tasting than Farmer Smith's. Whereas something like the sneaker industry, there is differentiation. There are people, Nike and Reebok and so forth. They have different brands, and there is some differentiation, and they do advertise. So the point is they're going to say, yep, see, they're wasting all that money on advertising, just trying to capture things from, so the average price to make sneakers is higher because of monopolistic competition. It would be more efficient if we could just have a uniform type of sneaker sold by everybody. All right, so there's a million things wrong with that economists before Rothbard have pointed out. But one thing that he points out is there's something fishy about this geometric argument. He said, it crucially relies. He said, what's going on here? How are they getting the result that it just pops out that it has to be the case that with a downward sloping demand curve, you have, output goes down, prices go up, and you end up intersecting, the point of tangency with this thing occurs higher than the minimum point. He said, that's crucially dependent on the fact that this is a smooth curve. And that's just something that they make for convenience. The mainstream textbook writers don't think that anything hinges on that being a smooth curve. They just think, well, we're just doing that to draw a nice curve. Just what else would we do? What difference does it make? And he shows, well, what if it's like that? What if you had a kinked average cost curve? Then you could have a downward sloping demand curve that hits that point, is tangent to it. If tangency doesn't really work here, but you get the point, at the lowest point. Now, so you know, Rothbard, he didn't really dot all the I's and cross all the T's here, right? It's not worth getting into because some of you don't even know what the standard exposition is. But there are some holes here, but Walter Block, who'd you do it with, Bill? Walter Block and Bill Barnett have a paper where they flesh it out. So Rothbard was on to something here. He didn't quite get it right. But the point is he had the brilliant insight of realizing, no, that is just an artifact of the assumption of a smooth cost curve, and once you get rid of that, the whole argument falls. The geometric argument falls apart. In addition to the verbal arguments we can make against the approach. All right, so talk to Walter if you want to see they actually give numerical examples, like showing with the calculus and everything. So it's for sure that works. Whereas here, it's not as obvious because Rothbard didn't fill in all the steps of the argument. Okay, one more thing. I'll turn over your questions. This is, I think, my all-time favorite critique of Keynesianism. So this is, all this stuff comes from Man, Economy, and State. So there's this one section where Rothbard he's going to blow up this idea of the investment multiplier that Keynesians come up with. So right now, he's recapitulating the Keynesian argument. So he says, it goes something like this. The Keynesians start out with this identity that total income is equal to consumption plus investment. Okay, yeah, that's true. And then you assume that there's a constant marginal propensity to consume. So let's say that consumption is always 0.8 of income. Now that's not a definition. That's not as true as this thing is true, but the Keynesians think that's pretty reasonable to assume that people, you know, you give them more income, they consume a fraction of it, but not all of it. Okay. And then what happens? And then they say, well, look at this. So we're taking this equation and we're rewriting it here. So you got income, but then instead of consumption, we're plugging in 0.8 times income, and then you're bringing this investment down, and then you're just going to do algebra. So you subtract that, so now on this side, you know, this turns into 0.2 times income equals investment, and then look, oh my gosh, you divide through by the 0.2, you get the total income and the economy is equal to 5 times investment spending. And that's where the Keynesians come up with the investment multiplier. And so look at that. If we're in a slump and we have idle resources, the government just needs to spend $100 billion making roads and bridges and stuff like that, and that will add $500 billion to GDP once all is said and done because of the magic of the multiplier. And the Keynesians say, you think that's wrong? Well, look it, we're doing it with math. You know, so you guys are, you Austrians should take up algebra sometime. Okay, so Rothbard points out the specific flaw with that, but then he does a reductio ad absurdum to show, okay, let me just make sure you see just how stupid this is. So he says, okay, let's do a different tautology. The social income is equal to the income of the guy reading my book, Man, Economy, and State, plus the income of everybody else. That's true, right? And then he says, I'm going to observe the income of everybody else is about, you know, almost all of social income, but not quite. That's true. And then watch what I can do with that. Social income is the income of the reader plus this. Rearranged social income is 100,000 times the income of the guy reading my book right now. And that is exactly as valid as the Keynesian demonstration. So Rothbard concludes, the government shouldn't stop with this piddly little 5 times multiplier investment. They should send checks to the guy reading my book right now. Right? Because if we gave him $5,000, there'd be a 100,000 multiple in terms of raising GDP. Right? So the point is, if you think through, okay, this can't possibly be right, what's going on? And you realize this was the crucial step, that number doesn't need to be the same. What would happen is if you took money from everyone through taxes and then gave it to, or by deficit spending, and then gave it to the reader, that number would change a little bit. It's not that would stay exactly the same, so that meaning this would have to stay the same, so if the income of the reader goes up, that's got to go up by 100,000 times. That's not what would happen. Okay, so something is, you can see the fallacy in an example like that, and then you go back and say, oh wait, is there something different with the Keynesian argument about investment spending? And Rothbard had shown that no, there really wasn't, that it's literally an analogous argument. Okay, we got about 5 minutes left. Let me turn over to your questions. Did Walter leave? Walter, do you want to say anything about Rothbard, or like what's your favorite contribution he made? All right. Well, what were Rothbard's greatest contributions to geopolitical warfare? All right. Does anyone else have anything scholarly to say? Okay, yeah.
Did Rothbard ever contribute anything to business cycle theory, like when he restates it in Man, Economy, State, America's Great Depression? I know he actually writes it in his own way. Did he add any insights, or is he pretty much kind of saying what Mises said?
Okay, so in case you guys couldn't hear it, the question is, did Rothbard contribute anything to business cycle theory per se? Well, at the very least, you know, that was a contribution in terms of economic history and how do you apply to that period. I don't think he changed the theory per se, at least in that book, but what he did might have done that hadn't been done was to just, like, that is a task. How do you, like, do you count bank deposits? Do you count this? So in terms of how do we measure what the money supply is, that sort of thing. So off the top of my head, and maybe someone wants to afterward add something to it, I don't think he supplemented the theory per se in that particular book or, to my knowledge, elsewhere. Maybe one more question. Yeah, right there. Uh-huh. Okay, so the question is on imputation theory. So there, Peter Klein is the expert. I think, if memory serves, that Rothbard cleaned it up a little bit. So the people, it was sort of like what Walter did, and Walter and Bill Barnett did with this thing. That, like I said, Rothbard, you know, gets the credit for he coming up with the brilliant idea, but technically he didn't execute it perfectly, and then they just kind of cleaned it up, the argument. I think that's what, by analogy, Rothbard did with the imputation stuff. Earlier thinkers had the basic idea, like this is the way you explain prices when there's joint output and that kind of stuff, but they didn't quite dot all the I's and cross all the T's, and he did it, you know. So if you're going to read it somewhere, read it there, because he did it properly and made sure it all was internally consistent. But I don't think he came up with any novel insight in how do you explain factor pricing in these various scenarios. Okay, why don't we end there? Thanks, guys.